I missed you all last week. I had to go home and be with my family, with my mother. And I appreciate very much the prayers that this body has made for my mother. They are working. Praise the Lord. And there was a time when she was eating, and I mean, it was a miracle to have her eat 200-300 calories.
Wow.
And now she's having, you know, 3 square meals a day.
Thank you, Jesus.
She's Amen. Off the supplements for food. Amen. And God is with her. Amen. I thank God for that. I mean, I love my mother. I feel it would be premature if she went now. But, you know, even if she hadn't pulled through, right, I know I would see her one day again.
Amen.
That is the assurance we have in Jesus Christ, and that is the hope of the resurrection. I also want to welcome my friend Mary. She's my senior at work, but she was willing to come and see me teach, so I really don't want to mess up. So once again, please pretend like this is really good stuff, right? So you fool her. All right, lots of amens and stuff like that.
Yeah, right, preach. Amen. There we
amen. Go. It's good practice. We're going to be in Luke 10. Luke 10, and like this is a long passage. If you wish to stand, you may, but it's Luke 10, verses 25 through 37.
Amen.
Good we are going to have a translator in the second half, I believe. I know traffic is really bad out there. And so he is on his way, Brother Salvador. Salvation is on its way.
Yes. Amen.
And when he gets here, he'll join me. But for now, Justin Iglesias. Starting with verse 25. We have to pay attention because I'm not going to reference this, so please be with me here. Luke 10, verse 25, it says, "And behold, a lawyer stood up to put him being Jesus, to the test, saying, Teacher, what shall I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, What is written in the law? How do you read it? And he answered, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength, and with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And he said unto him, You have answered correctly. Do this, and you will live. But he, desiring to justify himself, said to Jesus, And who is my neighbor? Jesus replied with one of the most famous stories in the Bible. A man was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he fell among robbers, who stripped him and beat him and departed, leaving him half dead. Now by chance a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, as he journeyed, came to where he was, and when he saw him, he had compassion. He went to him and bound up his wounds, pouring on oil and wine. Then he set him on his own animal and brought him to an inn and took care of him. And the next day he took out 2 denarii and gave them to the innkeeper, saying, Take care of him, and whatever more you spend, I will repay you when I come back. Which of these 3 do you think proved to be neighbor to the man who fell among the robbers? He said, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said to him, You go and do likewise. Amen. Amen. You may be seated in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Today I would like to talk on the topic, My World Needs You Now.
Yes.
My world needs you now. Two events in the last 2 weeks approximately have affected my life greatly and brought into very clear relief frankly, depressed and in a battle for her health. She has been kind of a rock in my family since I have been alive, right? And to see her needing me to pray for her, to be strong for her, to encourage her, to remind her what the Bible says, was a different situation.
Right.
And I thought, man, how frail life is.
Yeah.
Right? It really is. As the Bible says, it's a vapor. We are here 1 minute and we are gone the next.
Right.
And the second was a loss of a friend at work. Mary Jason, as you saw the emails, he was a friend of mine. He was 30 years old.
Wow.
And we were friends. He came to our home group. He and I had a Bible study together. And yesterday I was grateful to be able to go to his funeral. And it was very hard to see a father grieving for his son who died out of time, right? Before his time. Out of season, in my opinion. And so I've been thinking about these things, reflecting on these things, praying about these things for the last couple of weeks. And it's not a very deep conclusion, but the time that we have to impact somebody's life for good is so short. The time that we have, you and I, to impact somebody's life for Jesus Christ is so short. We are not guaranteed tomorrow. And I'm not trying to put fear or use this as an intimidation factor. It is reality. It is life. And it hit home for me very much in the last couple of weeks. And I started to think about the value of every interaction we have. The value of every opportunity to help somebody who is in need. And as I thought about when I found out that I was going to teach this weekend, the Lord immediately spoke to me and said, you need to talk about the Good Samaritan. Because of this, because the opportunities in our life to help somebody who is in need are precious.
Yes, they are.
And they need to be seized. We can't turn a blind eye to those who are in need around us.
Amen.
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 But we need to seize those opportunities. It doesn't matter if they ever come to Living Hope to church.
Right?
Right? It doesn't matter if we ever see them again. Right. What matters is that God has given us a commission to go into all the world and to preach the gospel.
Yes.
But not just to preach it, to live it.
Amen.
To go and make disciples. This means doing what is right.
Amen. Amen.
To whoever we come across who might be in need. And so, in a home group this week, we sang this song. I think Kirk Franklin sings it. I don't know. It was like 17 different people who sang it at some point. But I think he was the first name I saw. And it was this song, My World Needs You Now. And through the story of the Good Samaritan, I want to pose this question. Who is the you that the world needs? My world needs you now, but who is the you that the world needs?
That's good.
Certainly, and what the song was singing about was Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
The world needs Jesus now. Whether or not you've had my experiences the last couple of weeks, the events in Florida, the events at that the restaurant, that Texas Roadhouse, that is enough to tell you that the world needs Jesus.
Right.
Right, the world needs, we could say this, love, right? But the Bible says God is love.
Uh-huh.
Yes.
And so it's very clear the world needs Jesus, and we'll see that the Good Samaritan is actually a figure or a type of Jesus Christ. But more than that today, I want to talk about the other option for who that you might be. And that is that it is each of you who sit here today. Our world needs each of us to be vessels of the love of God.
Amen.
The Samaritan is a picture of someone who loves their neighbor as themselves. 1:30, 45, however long I go, minute session. Try not to scare Mary away. It might be more like 50, 55. I won't break 60, I promise. But I will take my allotted time.
Amen. That's good. Go ahead.
I know. I realize it's impossible for me to say, be so eloquent and to be so compelling up here that everybody would walk away and then the rest of their life they would live as the Good Samaritan lived. Even though we might all want to and all endeavor to and try our best, it's just one teaching on one Sunday, and we need God's help to do something in our hearts, to change us, transform us into what He wants us to be. One author has said, we would learn a lot more about the Good Samaritan by feeding the poor in a homeless shelter than by dissecting Luke 10 in a Sunday school class. And that truer words may have never been spoken. But I'm going to dissect Luke 10. Now I'm going to go on and dissect Luke 10. But the point that I'm trying to make is that doing is what's important here.
Yes.
We're going to talk about this. We're going to talk about why we should do it. And maybe the reasons that these other men failed to do it. But ultimately, it is on us to take action on our beliefs and what we profess to be our faith. Amen?
Amen.
Eternal life is a gift from God. The inspiration for our story was a question that was posed to Jesus by this lawyer. Now, he was not a lawyer of Virginia or D.C. state law. He was a lawyer of the Bible. He was a biblical lawyer. He studied the scriptures. And he came to Jesus, and like many times, he was trying to trip him up, or trying to test him, or trying to try him. And he asked him this question. He said, what do I need to do to inherit eternal life? And Jesus did not give him the satisfaction of an answer. Many times, Jesus gave a question, and he did this again. He said, well, what does the Bible say, essentially? He says, what does the law say? How do you read it? In other words, you're a lawyer of the Bible. Why don't you tell me how I inherit eternal life? And the lawyer answered, and he said, well, you've got to love God. He quoted from the book of Deuteronomy. And he says, you've got to love your neighbor, and quoting from the book of Leviticus. And then Jesus affirmed the answer. Jesus didn't say, no, that's wrong. That's all wrong. He said, yes. And then he said, do this. Do it. And you will live. Right? The emphasis of Jesus Christ was on the doing.
Amen.
This means putting action to our faith. If we say we have faith, if we say we love God, then what are we doing about it?
Amen.
Amen. If it's just a statement, then it's just words. They say the proof is in the pudding.
Right.
I don't know what that really means.
Amen.
I've eaten lots of pudding, and I've never found any proof of anything.
I know. What does that mean?
Besides, I like sweets.
Right.
But you know what I mean when I say the proof is in the pudding.
Amen.
Does our faith drive us to take action? You know, the other day, I'll be a little bit transparent. You say, that's a minor deal. Yet the other day, there was a man on the metro who's asking for something. Like, I'm cash? No, who carries cash anymore? Right? So I walked up, and I'm walking up the escalator, and, I get to the metro just in time to get the metro going, because I take the bus to the metro. And so I'm hoofing it up that elevator, and the Lord says, you've got some cereal in your backpack for breakfast. That to him. I'm like, I gotta go. I'm not gonna make this train. And I'd like to tell you, I got up, came back down the escalator, and gave that man that cereal, but I did not. Right? And you say that's maybe a small thing, but you know what? God wanted me to help the man.
Right.
The man was in need, and sometimes they won't take food.
Right.
But when someone's in need, our responsibility is to help them.
Amen.
Amen. So I'm not up here trying to portray someone who's arrived and made it.
Right.
I'm being honest. This is a constant struggle. But the reality is that none of us can love God so perfectly and love our neighbor so fully as to attain eternal life.
Right.
The question that the lawyer posed in itself was kind of the wrong question. Mm-hmm. Hey, what can I do to attain eternal life? And Jesus kind of said, you know, well, jump 10 feet high. You can't do it. You can't. None of us can love God and love our neighbor with absolute perfection. The Bible says in Romans 3 and 23, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. Eternal life was, is, and always will be a gift of God's grace to fallen humanity. There is nothing we can do to earn it, though we may try our best to fulfill the greatest commands of Scripture, to love God and to love people. We will always fall short. And in this statement, Jesus now tested the lawyer when he said, do this and you will live. Right? Instead of conceding the point and saying, well, wait a second, I can't do that perfectly, the lawyer sought to justify himself. The lawyer was very self-righteous, and he blew right past the point of Jesus. And he says, well, you know, who is my neighbor? To justify himself, to be justified in Bible terms, means to be saved. So the lawyer was saying, attempting to justify himself, he was trying to prove that what he was doing was good enough to be saved. The lawyer wanted Jesus to endorse his lifestyle and standards, which I'm sure were very high according to the day. He was a lawyer, he was a student of Scripture, and so he probably thought, you know, I'm doing pretty good. And so I think who's my neighbor? I think I've probably got it covered, right? My fellow Jew, you know, mom, the in-laws, okay, I'll concede that one. I gotta love them, right? And see, he was kind of hoping that Jesus would endorse what he already was doing. But I tell you this, Jesus did not go to a cross and die because we were making it okay by ourselves.
Right, right.
I mean, come on, if we could achieve a moral standard that was good enough to inherit eternal life, then why in the world did Jesus go to a cross and die?
Amen.
Why would God send his only son if we had it covered?
Right.
The answer is we do not. And we need a savior.
Yes.
We need somebody to help us. We cannot jump 10 feet high. We need someone to take us by the hand and lift us up.
Amen.
Where we fall short.
Amen.
That is the grace of God that does that. And Jesus is not interested in endorsing your lifestyle at all. Even if we are Christians saved for 50 years, he is not interested in endorsing our lifestyle. He wants to engulf our life in his. He wants to take our life into his and say, your life is no longer yours, but it's now mine. You walk as I do. You do what I do. Your standards are my standards. And you can't even meet them unless you trust my grace and my mercy every day. That is what Jesus wants from us. The lawyer asked for a definition. Give me a list. Who's my neighbor? Maybe I can do it. He thought maybe that he could manage this list. Maybe he thought Jesus would quote. He had already quoted Leviticus 19 to him. Leviticus 19 and 18 says this: thou shalt not avenge nor bear any grudge against the children of thy people, but thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. That's where you get that verse. So maybe he was thinking, all right, the children of thy people. It means my neighbor is my countryman, my fellow Jew. If I love them, then I have loved my neighbor and fulfilled the law. Now, if you go to verse 34, it says you got to love the foreigner as yourself too.
Yeah.
But maybe he didn't read that far. I don't know. Perhaps he would have said, well, I can do that. You know what? I'm already doing that. I truth is, it is far easier to love people who are like us those who are different.
That's right.
Amen.
It is far easier to love those who look like us, talk like us, maybe smell like us, or at least their food smells like ours. A lot easier to love them than it is to love somebody who's, in some sense, great. There's just something we don't like about them. Yeah. Or we don't want to get too close to that because, after all, we're respectable. I mean, look, I got a suit on. I'm in church. But that is not what the story of the Good Samaritan is calling us to.
Thank you, Lord.
The story of the Good Samaritan is challenging us to love beyond our own abilities. It is challenging us to love those that maybe we now hate. Listen, I know I'm in this country, right? I see the news. I can see what's going on. I see what's going on in our world, and I'm not so foolish as to assume that the spirit of hatred has not touched the church and has not come into our hearts and into our minds. Right? The spirits of racism, the spirits of us against them. But I will tell you that has no part in God's church. It has no part in God's church. Of all people, we are to be blind to those sorts of things.
Amen.
We should be as if we do not even see them.
Amen.
Nor consider them.
That's
the Bible says, do not be overcome of evil, but overcome evil with good.
Yes.
Instead of allowing hate to grip us, we need to allow love to overcome hate, to overcome evil, to overcome the spirits of this world that would try and pit person against person, neighbor against neighbor. That's the church's job. We're to be the standard that everybody says, man, look how they love one another.
Yes, amen.
Look how they love others. Because then the world would want to be like the church. Amen.
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 Good.
The story of the Good Samaritan challenges us. You know, now I'm not so sure whether or not you're just saying it's good because I asked you to.
That's good.
Come on. That's
no.
Good. Come on.
I just need to help you all. Amen. The story of the Good Samaritan. I mean, I was on a serious note there, too. The story of the Good Samaritan challenges us to sacrifice our time, our resources, our comfort, and I will clarify this later, but maybe even our safety to fulfill God's mission. We've got to get the order right, though. The order that Jesus used in this story is important. The order that the lawyer used is important. He tells us first, love God, then to love our neighbor. Elsewhere in the scriptures, Jesus himself used that summary. In the book of Matthew, he used that summary himself. But experience, it's important for this reason. Experience teaches us that it is hard to love the unlovely unless our heart is already filled with God's love.
Yeah.
It is really hard to love somebody who is unlovable. If the love of God is not filling your hearts, it's not just naturally in us to love unconditionally where we receive no benefit, where it's only sacrificial love. But the love of God must do that to us. The love of God working in us and through us, it will provide the energy and the motivation for the difficult work of loving our neighbor.
Amen. Amen.
And I'll be honest, it is difficult work.
Amen.
I chose Kristen because she was easy to love. But you know, marriage is still work. Even someone so easy to love, I'm like, marriage still takes a lot of work.
Right.
You know, she told me she was going to body slam me today. I said, that is the love of God. So I naturally did the right thing, and I teased her more. Amen. But it's easy to love like us, as we've said. But when we have to love somebody who may be less lovable, it may not give anything in return. It is much harder.
It's hard.
Right? And we may even take that plunge. We may even decide, listen, I'm going to serve that person out of love. You know, I'm going to sacrifice. I'm going to do something for them. And I'm going to show them that I love them. And you know what? They don't care. Or they reject it. What does that do? That's going to bring a feeling of disappointment. That is going to hurt your heart. And you're going to be very tempted. And you will think, if you're human, I think, you'll say, well, forget that. You know, I didn't have to do that. I didn't have to spend my money on you. I didn't have to spend my time on you. I didn't have to go out of my way. And you reject what I gave you. Who are you? That's the last time you will hear from me. If we minister out of our own love, if we serve out of our own reservoir of love, human love, then that is going to be a challenge.
That's right.
It's going to be a challenge to give that sacrificial love to our neighbor. Mm-hmm. But if we know that God loves us, and we are full of His love, and we are convinced that His love is unwavering for us, and that He is pleased when we do what He asks, then it's going to give continued motivation to love sacrificially. It doesn't, because it doesn't matter how the person responds. All that matters is how he responds.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. We've got to get to the point where we don't care how they respond as much, and more how he feels. Are you pleased with me, Lord? Am I doing what you've asked me to? Well, if I am, then I can keep going. Right? If I am, then I can keep sacrificing and I can keep loving. But if it's all us, and if it's what the other person feels towards you, or how they respond to you, we're going to be disappointed. We're going to get frustrated. And we might quit. Amen. I know it's a little quiet in here. But it's true. I know we've all felt it on one level or another. But God's desire is that we would love our neighbor as ourselves. Now we get to the story of the Good Samaritan, the actual account of the Good Samaritan. The Bible tells us that this victim in our story, there's a lot of background here, but he was Jewish. The victim is assumed to be a Jewish man. Okay, just based on the cultural context, all that. Okay, you gotta trust me. And he was on his way from Jerusalem to Jericho when robbers came and they stripped him of his garments. Now you might think this is odd. It doesn't say that they took his visa. It doesn't say that they stole cash or gold or anything like that. But in that time, clothes were expensive. Everything that was made was handmade. They did not have automatic sewing machines. And so clothes were very costly. This is why they cast lots for Jesus' garments at the cross, because they were worth something, even if bloodstained and tattered. And so they attacked him and they stole his garments. A common person may have only had two garments, an inner and an outer garment to wear. And so in the Middle East, it's very common for robbers not to beat somebody unless there's resistance. And so the Bible tells us this man was beaten and left half dead. So he must have made the mistake of fighting back. He was a fighter, right? He wasn't going to let him just take from him. And so the robbers beat him mercilessly, leaving him naked and probably unconscious on the side of the road. A terrible experience. A terrible ordeal. And the priest comes along, right? And he passes on the other side. Why would he do this? In the temple, okay, the temple at this time was in Jerusalem. And we know that this man was on his way down from Jerusalem to Jericho. And the temple at that time was served by three classes of people. So you had the top of the food chain, so to speak, at the top of the ladder was the priest. They were the most elite class at that time. Then you had the Levite. So the priest is the one who would offer the sacrifices. He was what we would call the bishop. Right? He was the bishop of the church. The Levite would assist the priest in ministering. He might be like a pastor or an assistant pastor. He was a minister, though. And then the third class of people was just the normal, everyday people that worked in the temple and attended to both the priests and the Levites. And so during this time, the priests were, I mean, we would consider them rich. But it was very common for them to live in Jericho. And what they would do is they'd go and they'd spend some time at the temple and they'd go on a rotation for however long it was. And then they'd travel from Jerusalem back to Jericho. And so if we were living at that time, this story would make a lot of sense to us. We'd say, okay, this priest, he was traveling from the temple. He just got out of church. He was going home. And he was on his way, right? And he came across this man. And because he was rich, this was a 17-mile journey from Jerusalem to Jericho. And because he was rich, those who heard Jesus tell this would have probably assumed he was riding an animal. A rich person would have had the means to ride on a donkey or something like that. And so they were assuming that here comes the priest riding down on his way from Jerusalem, and he sees this man, and instead of stopping him, stops his donkey and goes to the other side. But the point I'm trying to make is this priest could have easily picked up this man and put him on his animal. He had the means. He had the ability to help this man in a way that we find the Samaritan later helped this man. And you have to ask the question, why would the priest, why would the bishop have passed by? And the best explanation that I was able to find was ceremonial impurity.
Right.
At that time, because he was a priest,
right,
if a priest touched something or someone that was dead, they became impure.
Right.
So what would that mean for him? It means he would have become unable to minister for at least 1 week. It also meant he needed to return to Jerusalem and undergo a week of ritual cleansing. In other words, he had to go out of his way.
Right.
A large inconvenience. During this time, he could not receive tithes, nor eat of them, right? Because of the sacrifices, that was how they ate. Nor could his family. So he would have suffered financial loss if this man had happened to be dead. And so there were other reasons. But essentially, it would have cost him time and most likely money. And the priest wasn't sure what to do. And so the priest decided that it was not worth the time or the money or the inconvenience to help this man lying half dead on the side of the road. In other words, the priest had too much to lose to help this man. It'd be better just to avoid the situation altogether. How often do we stop short of helping someone in need because it will cost us time,
come on,
or money, or it's very inconvenient? And you may be saying, well, Brother Sam, how far do you want us to take this? Right? Okay, give me some guidelines here. Tell me how much I gotta give. Right? Isn't that, man?
Yeah.
I mean, that's where my mind went, I'm telling you. Maybe you guys are way more spiritual than me. But how far do you want us to take this? And the answer is I'm not going to tell you how far to take it. That's the same question the lawyer asked. Who's my neighbor?
Well,
that's a big deal. Okay, who's my neighbor? I'm not going to tell you what you have to do. The answer is you have to, I can't tell you how to apply this to your own life. You have to decide what you will do. We are people of faith. We have a walk with God. We hear from God. I hear from God. Amen? God speaks to us through His Word, hopefully through the message today. Through other means, through other people, through all sorts of things. And if we are God's people filled with His Spirit, then we need to pray. And we need to be able to know how far God wants us to take it at any one time. I cannot tell you when you come upon your man lying on the side of the road what to do. You understand what I'm saying?
Amen.
It may not be that situation.
Right.
I cannot tell you how far to take the sacrifice. But you have to know this. You're not making the sacrifice to check a box.
Right.
Amen.
This is not about doing it so you can say, yes, I am a good person,
right,
and I have fulfilled my duty.
Right.
Our job is to love people to the cross.
Amen.
Our job is to love people to Christ.
Yes.
And if that means helping a man half dead on the side of a road, then that's what it means.
Right.
Our job is to love, because our mission demands that we love.
Yes, sir.
We will never accomplish what God has for us. We will never accomplish God's mission or plan for our lives if we will not love one another. If we will not love our neighbor.
Amen.
Amen.
Help us, God.
I'm trying to say it in another way. There's these times in my messages where I feel I'm completely ineffective. Now is one of those times.
No.
But what I'm trying to say, it goes back to the initial point. The time we have is so short.
Yes.
So
yes.
Precious.
Amen.
Amen.
We don't know if we'll ever get another opportunity to influence somebody's life.
Amen.
We don't know if we'll ever get another chance to help them.
Amen.
And your thing, your act of love, your act of service may be what sends them toward God or away from God.
Uh-huh.
It might be the thing that makes their day or breaks it. Right? I'm saying before you, right? Life or death. Blessing and cursing. Right? And the answer is choose life, right? That you may live. But when we come to people, when we come to those situations, no one can tell you what to do, how far to take it, how far your love will take you, or how much your love will cost you. But you have to work your own salvation out with fear and trembling, as the Bible says. All right, let's move on to the Levite. What was the failing of the Levite? Man, I'm going slow. Amen. The Levites assisted the priests, as I said. Perhaps he was the second to arrive. It would make sense because he had been following the priest. And the priest was ahead of him because he was writing. But I would ask, why might it be that the Levite did not help? And the most compelling answer I came across in my study was that the priest had set the precedent. And the Levite followed his example. Surely if the priest had passed him by, it must be the right thing for me to do also. After all, if the priest felt it was okay to leave the man on the side of the road, then who was the Levite to show him up? Was he more righteous than the priest? Was he a greater man of God than the priest? But ultimately, the Levite was too bound by religious practices and norms to do the right thing.
Right.
He was too concerned about offending someone or making somebody uncomfortable than doing what was right. James 1:27 says, pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and widows in their affliction. You know what that means? It means help somebody.
Amen.
That's pure religion and undefiled. Help somebody in need.
Amen.
The fatherless who can't take care of themselves. The widow who can't provide for herself. Help those in need. That is true religion. That is pure religion. How often do we do what the Levite did? And we ask ourselves whether Pastor Staten would do it. God forbid you say, well, would Pastor Sam do it? Amen? Well, would they walk? If they walked it, then I'm going to walk. I've done that in my life. Well, what would they do? Right? We're supposed to ask, what would Jesus do?
Amen.
Right? That's the right one. Not some other man or some other leader. Right? I thank God for Pastor Staten. I thank God for our leadership. Right? But we are to follow them only as much as they follow Christ.
Amen.
Paul said, imitate me as I imitate Christ. As I imitate Jesus. There is no leader but Jesus who has ever lived without failing and falling short of what God had asked them to do. So the question is not, what would they do, but what would we do? Right? What would Jesus ask of us? God calls certain people at certain times. And this is where I'm hopefully transitioning to something more personal. He calls us in certain places and in certain ways. And the neighbor that God puts in your path is not the neighbor that God is going to put in my path. That's why I said the world needs you.
Yes.
I'm also including me, but somehow by having a microphone in my hand and standing at a lectern on a Sunday afternoon, I put space between us. Right? And we can be tempted to say, well, standard for Sam may not be standard for me. Right? Or the standard for Pastor may not be the standard for me.